see with the life of one person surrendered to God, which was a theme of my grandparents, a theme they let me talk about. What one person surrendered to God can do to affect and bless others. This was and is my grandma's legacy. She consistently and faithfully pointed away from herself, and she pointed others to Jesus Christ, who was the object of her love and adoration, her faith and confidence, her anchor and her hope. And I know that if she was here today, she would want this celebration of life, her life, to do the very same. To point away from her and to point to the grace and goodness of Jesus Christ that was displayed in and through her life. And so I would just like to begin by reading a liturgy of praise for Christ who conquered death. You have made all things well, O Christ. You have made all things well. What once was lost, you have reclaimed. What had been harmed, you will remake. What was unwell, you now restore. You make all things well. Hear the word of the Lord. Since the children have flesh and blood,
there is new solar plus battery backup.
So that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death. That is the
technology available that was just released.
Who all their lives were held in slavery.
We, your creatures, O Christ, once endured the cringing lives of slaves. In a long bondage bereft of hope, bowed
by the weight of grief, subjected to futility, fettered to our fear of death. But you did not abandon us. You were not content to see one speck of ground to the enemy of souls, or to the cruel kingdom of death. You were ever mindful of our plight. All praise to you, Lord Christ. For it was your intention from creation's dawn not only to make
all things, but to make all things right. When your works were despoiled and wrecked by sin and death, you undertook to save and to reclaim what you had first made good. You entered into this, our space and time, to act on our behalf. You took on body, blood, and breath that you clothed in our condition might move in sympathy to save and shelter us. For in the living temple of your flesh, perfect justice and perfect mercy were met. And there, in the shedding of your blood, they were forever reconciled in love. So you subdued the sting of sin. By death, you conquered death. You rescued us from the fear of death and from its power. You have made all things well, O Christ. You have made all things well. Hear the word of the Lord. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. The powers of darkness sought to swallow you in death's black waters, O Christ. But going under that flood, you drank death down like a river. You drank death's reservoir dry. All praise to you, Lord Christ. You swallowed death for us. And by that act of willing sacrifice, you pushed death back upon itself like the last lapping wave at the turning of the tide. That high watermark now fading. As death's dominion ebbs out for all time, its power to terrorize God's people forever, destroyed by God's own passage through it. Through death, O Lord, you gave us life. You have made all things well, eternal King. You have made all things well, O Christ. Death's dark shroud has been rent, ragged, and pierced through by the fierce dawning of your resurrection light. And after your return, after the final splintering of that dark night, death will possess no lasting fame. The works of death will win no glory for its name. Hear this promise, O children of God, hear and know. Death will surely die forever. His shoddy works undone, his usurped crown torn from his palsied grasp, his impotence unmasked, his power to harm shattered for all eternity, like shards of finished glass. Receive the glory due your name, Lord Christ. The grip of death already slips. It cannot slow the steady progress of the resurrection now advancing, one day to be made visible in the full outworking of its infinite glad implications. The door that led to death has been remade by Christ into the door that opens into everlasting life. Amen. You have made all things well. You have made all things well, O Christ. Hear the word of the Lord, for he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Now, O King of all space and time, raise your scepter, declare the advent of the age of the healing and remaking of the world, of the great rejoining of the realms of earth and heaven, of the eternal dwelling of God with his people in this reconstructed temple of creation. We who live in the shadow land of death's last stand await your appearance and command, O Lord. Every longing of our souls, every molecule of our physical bodies is crying out for, yearning for, reaching for, tilted toward the irresistible gravity of your being and your glory. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. We await your speaking of the word that will roll up death like an old disintegrated scroll, bind it with iron bands, and cast it into flames. Christ alone will wear the crown. Christ alone is worthy of the name above all names. Every knee will bow and every tongue proclaim the rightness of his coronation. All sorrows we endure for now are but the rattling gasp that signals death's defeat. Christ's heel is planted on death's neck. Death cannot breathe. And the space in which we grieve is but the long exhale of death's lasting expiring breath. This age of passing sorrows is but the long death rattle of death itself. The outcome bears no hint of doubt. The work is done. The victory is won. So death will be undone. All works of death will be undone. And we whose lives are hid with Christ in God will rise to live eternal, everyone. You have made all things well, O Christ. You have made all things well.
I understand this first song we're going to do was requested by the family, so hopefully it'll be a great memory for many of you tonight, today. Walking down the road of life, I find that in your heart you're just a lonely one. For you see, upon that very road, my search for good and truth had its beginning. You take a little turn to the left, can you see what that path has to offer you? Then you gotta make it back to the main road anyhow. And you have all that lost time to make up for. It's a sad thing to realize that you're all alone, that you're on your own. Walking down the road of life, can't you see that there are so many others? They are just like you. I was looking in that same direction, but all I ever found were others, and they were searching just like me. We didn't find the way or the answers to the questions that were buried deep down in our souls. We just found that the ways of men have no answers anyhow. Walking down the road of life, I know that deep down in your heart that you are just like me. What you're seeking is a better way. You're reaching out for temporary resting places, and you're glad to find a little peace of mind here and there. But it won't last, no, no. You'll have to move along someday till you're resting in the arms of the only one who can help you. Till you give your heart, your soul, your body, your mind, your very life to the Lord. And it's a glad thing to realize that you're not alone no more, that you found your way back home, back home.
Praise the Lord.
And that was a lot of us, right? I can't imagine how Chuck and Kay really felt when the storm of hippies just deluged this little tiny church. And you think about the patience that they had. Kay always struck me as a person that was just always praying about everything, was very, very insightful spiritually. And I loved when you come around on Friday morning, the parking lot was always full, right? Just as it is for you. But two little moments I had with Kay. Once we, first praise album was being done, and I had the mixes, and Pastor Chuck wanted to hear it. He said, come to the house. So I literally brought a reel-to-reel tape recorder over and started playing this, and he said, that doesn't sound like a praise album to me. And I went, what? And so he took all the fast songs off. And Kay walked through about that time, and a lot of people were involved from our community, Debbie and Ernie Retino, Peter Hawkins Jacobs, you know, and Seeky First was on there with Karen Lafferty. And Peter Jacobs got me to put strings on the album. Kay walked through on her way to bed. She went, oh, finally, something for us. And I went, oh, yeah, we've been kind of rocking and rolling your whole world here, right? Another one was, I was on a bus somewhere. I think Love Song guys were there, and Pastor Chuck and Kay were there. And we're having a Christian conversation, and somebody gets on the bus we don't know. Everybody clams up. And you can see every eye is going like, are you going to talk to this guy? No, I'm not talking to this guy. You're going to talk to this guy? Well, I don't know what to say. And Kay just gave us kind of this exasperated look, like, you guys, hey. And she didn't know the guy's name. Do you know Jesus? Just boom, like that, right, to a total stranger. And one of the things that has stayed the same through all the years, God's agenda hasn't changed. He wants the lost to come home, and he wants those who are home to grow up and not forget to reach out. And that's what Two Hands is all about. We're all gathered here because we all believe. If there's a doubter in the crowd, we ask you not to leave. Give a listen to his story. Hear the message that we bring. Feel the faith swell up inside.
I remember our going down Harbor Boulevard and seeing hippie kids, and especially one day, this was the final thing for me. I kept saying, why are they doing this? Why are they doing this? And I saw this girl, beautiful girl with a long dress, all alone on the sidewalk. It was evening. And she was so vulnerable, and she was spaced out. She turned and walked like she was going to walk right in front of the traffic, stood on the curb just uncomprehendingly. And she just turned around, and she walked back against kind of a window there, and that was it. I just said, Chuck, we've got to reach them. We've got to reach them. And that's, I think, when the greatest degree of passion was born. We have to.
I was one of the dirty hippies. Came up from Laguna Beach. Calvary at the time was in this little tiny building in the middle of a bean field. There were a lot of people that looked like me, so I thought I was pretty safe coming in. For the longest time, I just kind of stayed in the background, and I had a little white Bible that was zippered. It was a girl's Bible, but I didn't care. Just wanted to know Jesus. But I still didn't really know anyone, and I think it was that summer that I went to Pastor Chuck's birthday party at Irvine Park. And as I was walking down through the tables and everything, Kay reached out to me and she said, come and sit with us. And so I sat down with her and Jan, had lunch with them. We were friends ever since, just one of my favorite people in the world. I don't have enough time to speak about all the stories and the adventures that I have traveled with Kay and Chuck. In the beginning, when I was a young Christian, Chuck and used to take me with him to give my testimony because it was so unbelievable, and it probably was something that people had a hard time hearing. And then he would preach, and Kay would come with us sometimes, and you could see the dynamic between these two. They were so different, so opposite, but so compelling because of that that difference between their personalities. But just two of the most lovely people you'd ever meet, two of the most normal people that you'd ever spend time with. Sometimes we elevate people to this incredible pedestal because they are so anointed by God, so empowered by God. But they were ordinary people who gave their lives over to become invisible so that the invisible God could be seen through them. That's how I see both Pastor Chuck and Kay. Now they're gone, and it's heartbreaking. I can't believe that they're gone. They're like my parents, my spiritual parents. Kay was everything that people say she is and was, always concerned about everybody else and always concerned about me as well. And we used to work together on the pastor's wives conferences here. I worked alongside of her for about 10 years, and she was always just trying to bless everyone. And she would spend her time and her energy and her entire heart finding ways to make things more wonderful for people and draw them closer to Jesus. So in thinking about her and thinking about her as a person, I see her with Chuck, but I also see her with everyone. Because in my eyes, Kay was the heart of this church. If Chuck was the brains and the leader and the power, he was a powerful man and a powerful man of God as well. Kay was the heart of the church. Romaine was the grease of the church. One day I was talking to the Lord about what it would be like to see him, to finally get to that place where I've crossed the threshold. And I know that when I see him, I shall see him as he is, for I will be like him, but I can't fathom that. I fell asleep after praying about that, and I woke up in the morning, and it's almost like this song just kind of came to me. And it's a song about waking up from this bad dream in the kingdom of heaven. The little bird wings away down from on high through quiet green valleys and blue velvet skies to yellow orange flowers, a kiss from her beak, a wave from her wings, a touch from her feet. She flies to your window and lands on the sill and looks ever gently at you lying still with dreams of green valleys and blue velvet skies, with you walking in them with stars in your eyes. She begins to see. She begins to see. Wake this morning. Light fills your window and touches your eyes. Your lashes do flutter, and to your surprise, the world has unfolded like petals on roses do open when dawn brings the light. She begins to see. She begins to see. She begins to see. She begins to see. Wake this morning. Now you wander outside to the once barren land, the lily white lilies, the golden bright sand. The lamb and the lion lay down by the stream, and you are the child to lead them in peace. And on every tree is a garden's delight. The day never ends, there's never a night. And walking toward you is Jesus the King, standing beside him, your most precious thing. Your father and mother, your sisters and brothers,
I'm Greg, that's Kathy, and we're glad to be here. I want to thank Brian and Cheryl and the Smith family for asking us to come and say a few words about Kay. You know, we always felt we were her favorites, right? And Cheryl said, you know, your mom, really, you were some of her favorites, so I'm going to own that and thank God for that. But, you know, Kay loved this place. She loved this church. I think she always sat over there, didn't she? Yes, when Chuck would speak, and she poured her heart into this. And there's certain names that go together. Adam and Eve, Abraham and Sarah, Aquila and Priscilla, Billy and Ruth, and Chuck and Kay. Mm-hmm. Right? They were a team. And if Chuck was the father of the Jesus movement, then Kay was clearly the mother. And as it has been shared, and we'll hear more about this, you know, she just had this heart, and she would have Chuck drive her down to the pier, and she would look at these hippies, and they were praying for a way to reach them, but they didn't know a hippie. And as the story goes, one day Jan brought home a genuine, living, breathing hippie who ultimately brought in an even hippier hippie named Lonnie Frisbee.
Yeah.
And Chuck met Lonnie, and Nitro met Glycerin, and it exploded. And it was a genuine, bona fide spiritual awakening that touched the entire planet, called the Jesus Movement.
Amen.
For sure. And it was, you know, I came to Christ in 1970, and I didn't know I'd walked into a Jesus movement. I didn't know I was in the middle of a revival. I just came to this amazing church. I remember when they were singing Two Hands, you know, everybody would grab the hand of the person next to them. Some of you remember, and hold it up. With one, reach out to Jesus. With the other, bring a friend. Now we're too old, and it's too much work to do that, but... That's what we did back in the day. But something I discovered later, talking to Kay, and I talked to Kay a lot. She was so easy to talk to. I'd get on the phone for an hour and a half with Kay, and she just was just so easy to converse with. And she interpreted Chuck for me, because Chuck was a mystery to me. You know, Chuck was, when Chuck wanted to talk, he'd talk. When he didn't want to, he could be very quiet. And he would say something. You would say, Chuck, I wanted to share this with you. And he would say, oh? And it's like, Kay, what did Chuck mean when he said that? Oh, Greg, he loves you. He just, yeah. And she would explain everything to me and reassure me many times. But she told me later that she used to pray for a group of young kids that walked by her house. They were just these lost kids that went back and forth across, you know, the front of her home, near the, her home. And she said, I prayed for them, that one or more of them would get saved. And then one day it dawned on me, I used to go over to this guy's house a block over from where Chuck and Kay lived. I didn't know Chuck and Kay. I didn't know who they were. And this was our route we walked on every day. We were using drugs. We were lost. And I realized later, Kay was praying for me. And so... She was just such a wonderful person, and a lot's going to be said about her, and it's just, you know, she was used by God, and I think Odin summed it up well. You know, Chuck was the mind, he was the logic. I thank God the Lord put someone like Chuck at the wheel of this ship, because he was such a stabilizing force. In fact, he even looked like the captain on the Love Boat. Remember that, Chuck? He looked like it. You know, and he's just up there, all right, what a joy, you know, let's go. Whee! You know, that was Chuck. And Kay's just heart, emotion, pray, passion, perfect combination. And we were privileged to get to know them very well as friends. And they were like spiritual parents. So I never called Chuck Papa Chuck. I hear people say Papa Chuck. And I don't think we ever called Kay Mama Kay.
We didn't.
But we called him Chuck and Kay, or Pastor Chuck. And and so we're so thankful to be here. Kathy.
The last time we stood on this platform together was at our wedding. Almost 50 years ago. And yep. Isn't that wild to be here together?
Hair.
Yes, and Chuck pronounced as Greg and Lori, man and wife.
Yeah.
So Greg says that's the secret to a happy marriage, is you just marry yourself.
But, he did. Greg and Lori. So the secret to a long marriage is marry yourself.
I came to this church when it was the little church on Sunflower almost 50, probably 50 years ago.
Yeah, okay.
And I went to hear a hippie preacher named Lonnie, and I had no idea about Chuck Smith. Later on, I came to know there was a pastor at that church, and that that pastor had a wife, which absolutely fascinated me, because being raised Roman Catholic, priests don't have wives. So I had no concept of what that was like, to be married to a man of God, a minister.
She still doesn't have any idea.
he said that. But, you know... Kay was the, I had heard about Kay, but I didn't know her until a little bit later on. And it was so fascinating for me to sit and watch her. And the closest contact that I ever had with Kay came a few years after Greg and I got married, when she called together a group of us to be part of a board of women pastors' wives that would serve the pastors' wives of Calvary Chapel. And I was all of, I think, 24, maybe. And so never having had...
She still looks like any, she's 24.
Never... I never had any experience with ministry whatsoever. I was a pastor's wife, technically, because I was married to a pastor, but I had no idea what that looked like or what that would be like. But it was in those early meetings that I began to see the scope and the influence and the importance of a pastor's wife. And she modeled that for me. And I was so grateful for those meetings that we had. And we met for, I don't know how many years, decades together. And we would spend hours together every summer planning the retreats. And Kay was a perfectionist. I'm telling you, we would take 4 hours to write the letter to invite the pastor's wives to come to a retreat. And she showed to me the importance of words and that words matter, and she wanted everything to be just right. But what I also learned from Kay was that she was willing to take a chance on a younger person. I mean, obviously, I was very young. I had no experience. I was terrified. And she gave me that first opportunity to speak publicly before anyone. And boy, that was a gamble. When I look back on it now, I think, golly, why did she do that? I think because she had somewhat of a confidence in Greg and thought, well, Kathy's married to Greg, so maybe she knows something too. But I did stand up on that platform and speak, shaking in my shoes. And over the years, she continued to, as someone said, Cheryl said, that we are her favorites.
Yeah.
I always had this feeling.
Among her favorites.
Yeah. But I had this feeling, even though I was the youngest person at the time before Cheryl started on the board, that she really did like me, and she really was interested in my perspective. She was curious. She was fascinated by beauty and art and style, and I think that's what intrigued her also about the hippies in the very beginning, was she was just fascinated and curious and always wanting to learn. And so I saw that part of her. But apart from giving me my first opportunity in ministry and letting me see up close her honoring of Chuck and her love for the word and her passion to reach women, I learned in her not long after those meetings started, when she began really to invest in the women in this church through the Joyful Life Bible studies. And what I saw was Kay championing other women, leading other women. And she gave us and gave them the opportunity and showed us how important that small group community was in a church of thousands. She recognized that accountability and discipling and loving God's word and supporting one another happened in a small group long before it became the trend for churches to do small group, right? Kay was doing it here, and she gave me the template for what I have discovered is my passion and my ministry, and that is to reach women with the gospel and to recognize. And I have to say kudos to Chuck, who not only permitted Kay to do this, but really championed her by giving her the resources and the platform and the encouragement and the support that she needed. And I'm so grateful for that, because I was able to build and stand, kind of what they say, standing on shoulders of giants. I was able to follow in the wake that she carved for our ministry and for me in particular. So thank you so much for letting us share today. There's so many more things I could say, how fun she was and her sense of humor.
I think Debbie and Ernie are going to come.
We'll let
them
do that.
I don't know where they are, but let's pray for a moment. Father, we want to thank you for a life well lived. Mm-hmm. What else could be said? But she fought the good fight. She kept the faith. She finished the course. And now there is that crown of righteousness, which you, the righteous judge, have given to her and to Pastor Chuck. Thank you for the faith of this couple that left their comfort zone, that took risks.
Yes.
that were open to the leading of the Spirit, and they touched thousands of people, and a genuine spiritual awakening happened through them. Mm-hmm. And I know, Lord, they're in heaven now, and they're before your throne, and I know what they would want above everything else is to give the glory to you. Mm-hmm. So we give the glory to you, Lord. Thank you for the life of Kay Smith, and thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. God bless.
Hello, we are Debbie and Ernie.
Hi. Rutino.
If this were the old chapel, I would have been sitting about 15 rows back, about 1969, the end of 1969. And Chuck was preaching, and at the end he said, and if you want to accept Christ, I was there with Sandy McIntosh, and she was holding my hand. And she grabbed my hand because she saw me raise my hand. And it was kind of cool. But anyway, there you go. We're old, too.
In the old days, he used to say, I was singing that night when he got saved, and now he doesn't remember it.
Oh, yes, I do.
Okay.
I had a healing.
We are so thankful to be here to honor Kay. You know, some people knew her as Mama Kay, and I heard that from other people, but like Greg and Kathy, we never called her Mama Kay. We called her Kay. And one time I think I introduced her as Mrs. Smith because I was trying to be so proper. But she was a phenomenal person, inside and out. Kay was a gigantic force in the Jesus movement. Some people didn't have a clue how big a force she was. She had thousands of hippies showing up that she literally had prayed in. Her gift, above even her word of wisdom, her word of knowledge, her gift was prayer. And I have stood shoulder to shoulder with her when she was storming heaven for something. And I'm telling you, there was an anointing on Kay that changed the world. She doesn't get the same credit that a lot of the people that were on stage all the time. But I know what it was like backstage. I know what it was like on the phone with her. I know what it was like when she would, even one time standing outside, I had a headache, and she goes, we're going to pray for your headache. And I'm going, well, that's a little eccentric or something, you know. But it wasn't at all. She just dove into it and with her whole heart before the Lord. So I think that we can't really underestimate the number of people who they're saying it now to her in heaven. They're saying, thank you. Thank you for obeying the Lord. Thank you for serving him. Thank you for praying for me. Would that be cool to be in heaven and get to meet the people that were praying? Oh my gosh. That you prayed for. I mean, I think it's exciting. Anyway, Kay was gifted beyond anything that we had seen before. And what blows the mind in terms of geometric progression is how many people came to Christ, not just here, but how many people did they lead to Christ and that they led to Christ, and how many churches were formed just from Calvary alone, and then all the churches in addition to Calvary that were bolstered and encouraged to grow. And this didn't stop in the United States. It was not just a West Coast phenomenon. I was on tour all over the place. I saw what was going on all over the United States. I saw what was happening in England. I saw what was happening through Scandinavia and Russia. And it just was all this. And I tied this back to her faithfulness in prayer. She was a woman of great influence. and she was not the type to push herself forward. But she was a person who would pick up the mantle of leadership that God had for her. It takes courage to do that, because you can't really wear that mantle without sacrificing something else. And when she had that mantle on her, women all over the world sat at her teaching. She formed the Joyful Life Bible Study for Women. And like Kathy said, that was something that she was pulling women in, women pastors, women that were married to pastors, to be on the board. Now, that set a model that really was quite phenomenal. I actually was on tour one day and found a book that is a thesis that someone made a doctorate about. And it was about how the wives of the pastors at Calvary Chapel usually would handle the women's ministry. And they did it modeling after Kay. And what showed the effectiveness of Calvary Chapel, wherever they were positioned, was the women's ministry was the fuel. That was amazing. And that I tie back to her. And just think about all those engines going all over the world, in every tribe, every nation, everybody related to one another, with the spiritual DNA that came from the prayer that she had. But Kay was not just a minister. Kay was a mom. And that's mom spelled capital M, capital O, capital M. I taught music and drama the first year that MCA existed. And Ernie would come in and help me stage shows. And we used to, I'm sorry, what did you say? Oh, you did something.
I didn't say anything.
Okay. Jan Smith was on staff with me. I think she taught kindergarten. Yeah, it was great. And I taught music and drama and had all the kids, 800 students in the entire school. It's crazy. I loved it. I just loved it. But Ernie would show up and we would stage these shows. And we used to rehearse at Word for Today. And that was where Jeff was. And Chuck Jr., I thought he was kind of gorgeous, actually, so I've never actually said that before, but now I
hate you.
This is my image of the epitome of beauty and handsomeness. My husband is plenty gorgeous. Anyway, but that kind of rounds out the kids except for Cheryl. And Cheryl was 13 years old, and she was my student. So I think it's Ernie's turn.
Oh, it is my turn.
Yes.
Well,
okay.
I have to set this up a little bit, that I was young baby Christian, really. I was here, but somehow or other I got involved very quickly because I was a singer and leading worship and all. And
because I Chuck, thought you were cute.
Yeah, thank you. Chuck and Kay, as most of the people here have said already, were role models for us. But they were role models for us in our marriage.
Yeah.
And we didn't even know it at that time. But they were, because we were watching them. And my concept of who Chuck and Kay were is that they were perfect. They just simply were perfect. They never made any mistakes. Everything was right and it was clean and they were just good. And that's the way it was. And then one day, Cheryl was out. She was at school. And I guess she was probably about in the eighth grade or so. And she was crying, just hysterically sobbing. And I was walking around the campus. So I went up to her and I decided I was going to counsel her. And in my counseling, I had said to her, well, you know, you're the pastor's daughter, and there's a lot of pressure that comes, and I went on about with that, and that, you know, you really shouldn't have that, carry that kind of pressure. You need to put it on the Lord. Well, the phrase, you are the pastor's daughter and there is pressure, happened to be a buzz phrase for Kay. She did not want her kids under the pressure of being the pastor's children. Did not. Well, I didn't know that, and I happened to use that phrase. And Cheryl shared the story with her mom. Now, I was golden boy at that time, and I could walk into the office and, Chuck, I need to blah, 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 and come on in. And anyway, I'm thinking, I also at that time, I had a great problem with pride, and I know that I'm thinking, I'm going to walk into this office now, and someone is going to be there and say, oh, that was so nice of you to counsel Cheryl. You did such a good job. Well, I walked in, and there was Kay standing behind the counter, and, you know, she had sparkling eyes anyway, but she's looking now straight at me, and I don't know if I opened my mouth and said something. Did you hear about me counseling Cheryl? Blah, 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 and the pastor's, blah, and I said that phrase, and I'm looking, and I suddenly saw eyes that were like fire, just fire coming out of those eyes, and suddenly it was like she had claws, and she was at least Mama Bear at the top of the mountain, and she didn't take her eyes from me, and I felt she was going to just leap over that counter and bite my head off. And I went, oh, I mean, that was really exciting, to say the least. But after that, I mean, I had to tell you that I actually learned through that experience. First of all, it just scared the death out of me. I learned that women in the church are not necessarily demure. And you know, in the wind. What's that thing? The reeds. A reed in the wind. You're not a reed in the wind. Anyway, I am 72. All right, so, but anyway, so it was just exciting just seeing how this all was going to turn out for me. But I did learn lessons from it about just maybe that was like a main one. Let's just call it that.
Well, in spite of Kay's reaction, because she did the exact same thing to me on a different occasion, and in spite of Kay's reaction, we recognized anointing on Cheryl. We knew that God had something very special in store for her. And really, they couldn't stop us from coaching her because God had put her right in our lap. She was in our class, and we had the opportunity to help her step up into what we knew was coming because we could see that. That's a gifting that I have personally. And we were doing the spring recital. I'm going to tell this story, and she's already got her head down, you know. But I wrote a song called Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Jesus Christ is Risen. It's the one, if you really look for it on the YouTube, you can find me singing that song. Well, it's 5 minutes long. It's just ridiculously long. But Cheryl chose that song to sing for the spring recital. And I was excited about it because she has a beautiful voice. Don't ever let her tell you that she can't sing. That is not true. Because I have heard her sing, and she sang that song in the spring recital absolutely perfectly. She hit every note. I did not notice that she had inverted or something like that two of the lines. It just never occurred to me. I was so thrilled that she had hit the high notes. It was just gorgeous. I'm like, oh, this is great. Well, the thing that I saw, though, was she was upset about it. And her parents cared for her, not like they were in public and being pastors or being ministers, whatever. They were parents that just wanted to put their arms around her and hug her and give her, oh,
gosh, we're so sorry she muffed it on the, oh, wow, no. And it was like this tragedy. And I'm looking at this and I'm going, they're the best parents ever. I just like that heart that I was able to see. Now, I'm sure it wasn't like that all the time because there's always challenges in a marriage, but we started our marriage here. That was just one of many challenges.
Wait, it's my turn. Okay.
That was your cue.
Yeah, that was my cue. All right, well, anyway, we actually got married here in this church. We had a Jewish, let's put it this way, we had a Judeo-Christian wedding. And we had a chuppah, you know, the thing,
canopy.
Whatever, canopy kind of a deal. And both, you know, Debbie and I have Jewish heritage. And so that made sense, and Chuck allowed it to happen, which is kind of cool. And all the guys wore yarmulkes. Even Chuck had a little deal. And I've never told this, but when the ladies were coming down the aisle, and we were all looking, and this was another thing that blew my mind because...
Don't say anything anti-Semitic.
It's not that.
Please.
No, but Chuck was standing here next to me, and I don't know, I guess he thought maybe I was nervous, and he just kind of wanted to sort of break the ice or whatever, and he just turns and he looks over at me, and he goes, "Hello, cute little Jewish boy, I like your little beanie." It just cracked me up. It was really funny. But I had never seen, but he was always, you know, yes, but, and then was just that, and I just went, oh, this was crazy. But anyway, so we had this Jewish wedding, and Jewish weddings have a thing that's kind of like a communion service, and we had a really pretty bottle, it should be like a bottle of wine, and two bottles of wine, one would be red and one would be white, and anyway, it was... I think it was when we had the rehearsal that Kay suddenly comes up to us. And you know, Kay was just a non-drinker. And alcohol was not going to pass her lips. But she saw those bottles of wine on the stage. And she comes up and she says to us, "Those, are you going to put real wine in those?" And... the truth was, I'm so dumb, I didn't know. I looked at Debbie, and I saw her forming the N, and we both went, no, 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 no. That's going to be cranberry juice for the red and white grape juice for the white. And
then Kay goes, oh, I'm so relieved.
Yeah. It was great.
That was it.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, Chuck and Kay, they were supportive of everything that we did. We taught the kids at MCA all the stuff that we did with shows. And anything that we wanted to do, they just rolled out the red carpet for us. They made it possible. And we started writing our own shows. Ernie started making up puppet shows that he did for the primary grades in their chapel time. And that led to us producing the first Kids Praise album. And Ernie played Salty. So I don't know if any of you know that, but say something in your voice. Okay,
well, if this embarrasses you, it embarrasses me too. So here we go. Salty would say, "Hi, kids, it's me, Salty, the singing songbook. Praise the Lord." Ta-da. I am red already. It's just like, go ahead.
The thing was that Chuck and Kay encouraged every idea that we had.
Yeah, they did.
And without them, we wouldn't have had the space or platform to be able to do what we did, and for God to take the silly little blue book character with the high voice and take it all around the world. And that's mind-boggling. How to reach children. They just gave us the place and said, go have fun. Anything you want, just do it. Because I always expected a full house here. We usually had to do three shows in a row with people winding around the building. Anyway, One of the most important things that happened, though, was I couldn't get the High Tops show. I don't know if any of you remember that, but it was a show that we wrote for high school. I couldn't get it off the ground. It just wasn't moving anywhere. There was no traction. I couldn't get anybody to look at it. I gave it to Kay, and I said, please look at this. We can't get it going. And she didn't respond very well. She didn't call me back for like 2 months. And when she called back, she said, Debbie, this is really good. And I'm taking it to Chuck. And Chuck read it. And then we were, as soon as Chuck said, yes, this is it, that thing went all over the United States. Other churches have produced it. It's done in Europe, even. They have done it. We did it at Irvine Meadows. We did it.
Pacific Amphitheater,
yeah. All these crazy things from this little show. And when we were on tour, we even got to go to the Grand Ole Opry. And I was looking at this and watching how many people were coming to Christ through this. This show was even produced off-Broadway in Times Square last summer. And it just was amazing. I just went, wow, what an opportunity. They had an open casting call for people to of all different backgrounds to be able to come in, and it was beyond amazing. You know, it's hard to be a mom and a minister and a pastor's wife, because I've done it, I know. And I managed it sometimes, but sometimes I made some mistakes. And there's bound to be pressures that get in the way. But I wish I'd had a manual for how to do everything right. And I remember one day getting out of the car at my job at Saddleback Church. I was director of worship leadership there. And I had to hit the ground running and be greeting people and, you know, loving on people and all that kind of stuff, which is just not my nature. And after that, my kids came up to me and said, you are such a hypocrite. And I went, really? And they said, yes, you're not like that at home. I said, isn't it a miracle that I can do that at church? You know, that was the big deal. But I know that sometimes we don't always get along with our moms, exactly. And I'm sure that Cheryl had challenges, because Cheryl is so full of fire, and so is her mom. And I know that I had challenges with my own mom, but it seemed to ease off as she got older. And when she was 92, she asked me to perform her wedding to a young gentleman who was 86. And I said, okay. And so we did it in the backyard. All the grandkids came. It was very family. They all participated in everything. But when she was getting dressed, she dropped an earring. And the earring fell on the carpet. And we couldn't find it. It was a little pearl earring. And I was looking and looking and looking for that earring. And shortly after the wedding, she passed away. And I found that earring after she passed away. And that earring meant so much to me to be able to hold. And just to think about my mom being close to me. And I keep it right next to my bed at night. And I know that sometimes we hear their voices of our parents in our head. We hear our loved ones. You know, it's memories and echoes come back to us. And it's almost like we can see them, and it's like looking through cheesecloth. And we want to be able to push through and just touch them. But it doesn't work that way. We get to see them again fully in heaven. But here we are. And I take what I can get when I look in the mirror and I see my own mother looking back at me, because we look like each other. And that's exciting. But the big thing was is that anything I disagreed with her on seemed to disappear. That was something I wanted to share with you guys today, because I know that everybody can have that issue, you know, like what's it like once your parents pass? And it's big. And I would like for us to take that moment and recognize that sometimes when you remember the things that they said, it can become like little ripples, and hold on to the things that they said that were loving. And that can be very good. So. Ernie,
yeah,
let me close this up here.
That it's kind of been said already, but Chuck and Kay were and are still both pillars of the church, of this church. But not just this church, the church, as it's been said. They are pillars of that church. And when we were, I was praying about what we were going to share, about 30 seconds into the prayer, this scripture came to mind. And I hadn't thought about it in maybe 15 years, but it was Proverbs 25:12. And it in the King James, I have it memorized in the King James, and it's as an earring of gold and an ornament of fine gold, so is a wise reprover upon an obedient ear. So you picture this beautiful gold earring. It's just adorning this person. And it's making this a simile that the person who is wise in their counsel is like that. But the person who is listening, I think that's better. The person who is listening to the wise counsel is like the one who is adorned with the gold earring. Listening to that counsel, taking it in to heart, and then following through. And Kay was that, she was the person who was the gold earring. And hopefully we all were the ones who were listening and being adorned and taking the wisdom that she had and applying it. Because if you did that, you're probably sitting here. And that's why.
God bless you guys.
God bless you.
Kay had evidence in her life of joy, fun, laughter, Jesus.
She was funny, and she loved good coffee, and she loved chocolate and Häagen-Dazs ice cream.
She's the brunette to my mom's blonde.
She had a unique ability to just be herself. Kay was the same privately as she was up in front of the ladies, one of the more real people that I've ever known.
She had endless fascination regarding people and where they were coming from.
People that looked like they were lost or in need, she would always be attracted to them. She would always reach out to them.
It didn't matter who you were with her. It didn't matter if, you know, if you were a person of importance or whatever. She just cared.
So she has a way of making everybody feel special. You felt like you were the only person in the room and you were having a cup of coffee together.
I'd call, even sometimes at late at night, and she'd talk to me. We could talk it out. She was like the sister I never had.
She's my friend. She's my friend who lived next door, and if I needed some sugar, I'd go borrow sugar from Kay.
She had her fingers on the pulse and the heart of the women,
especially hurting women. And during the time when we started Joyful Life, there were a lot of hurting women. She really wanted to encourage them.
She was extremely sensitive to trends, extremely sensitive to people, but above all, she was extremely sensitive to the Lord. I believe she was the matriarch of the Jesus People movement.
I don't know that I would have had a ministry had Kay not modeled it and included me in the ministry that she had.
We stormed the gates, and we really prayed, and we battled, and we saw God work.
She loved the Lord, she loved her husband, she loved her children, and then she loved all of us. That's why so many called her Mama Kay.
When you have a mother who loves you and who nurtures you, her impact goes way beyond where you can possibly imagine.
She was happy in her last days. She was content in life.
And it's so easy to be discontent, but when we choose joy, oh, what a difference it makes in our own lives and all of those around us. I want to be content, and I'm finding the older I grow, the more I am sensing a contentment. Things that used to just make me crazy, now the Lord has a way of mellowing us out as we walk with Him.
First of all, Calvary Chapel was in existence for 4 years before Chuck and Kay ever came. The board hired Pastor Chuck and Kay to come on board in 1965. The first time I saw her walk through the doors of Calvary Chapel, she was this tall, elegant, sophisticated-looking woman.
Kay wore black, red, or blue. She did not wear pastels.
She was so good in red. She wasn't afraid to wear red.
She had an air about her that reminded me of Jacqueline Kennedy, actually.
One of my first memories of Kay was when I was 4 years old, and she was playing the piano across from my mom, who was on the organ, and they were practicing for that Sunday morning's hymns. And I would just listen to them play while I would color on the bulletins.
When I heard Chuck had a wife, I was intrigued that there was this woman in the background. And Calvary Chapel on Sunday mornings, Kay was there playing the piano, accompanied by an organ, and leading them in hymns.
Kay was a girl. She was a very inquisitive girl.
She was interested. She was fascinated. She was a learner.
Between my mom and Kay, they were always kind of getting into things in a good way. I don't know who kept who in line.
I think you have to understand how much fun we had in those early days. She would go, "Oh, Joyce!" And she would just get so excited about something. Or, "Oh, Kim! Cheryl!" You know, we just had this, and it was so much fun.
But she would speak her mind, too. She's like Cheryl in this way, where if she thought something, she would just say it.
Kay took one look at my skirt and went,
"Oh, girls, or you shouldn't do that."
That was a reprimand.
Well, it's just like me walking her back to the office, you know. "Shoo, shoo, little boy. Get behind me, Polly."
Then she began laughing.
And she would, "Oh," and laugh and giggle with it as we would do those things.
One time we were talking after a harvest crusade, and Kay said, "I don't know, I don't trust Greg Laurie." And I go, "Why?" And she said, "He rides a Harley. I think anyone who rides a Harley is a sociopath." And Chuck was choking back the laughter because he knew I had a Harley. But I wasn't going to tell Kay that because she was bagging on Greg. And so I just agreed with her. "Yeah, you're probably right." She loved Greg and loved listening to him. But at the same time, she wasn't sure about that Harley thing.
You know, people think she was outgoing. She was not outgoing. She was extremely shy.
She was not on the platform front and center.
Kay was not a show-off type of person at all. She wanted to be in the background a little more.
She didn't want people making a big deal out of her. She would sneak into the study. I would watch her sneak in. You know, I mean, she didn't want people making a big deal about it.
She relished in that, being in the background. And I think she had to be encouraged to go out and to be the teacher of all the women that flocked to the church.
It was an interesting time, though, culturally, because there were more people then than ever before, maybe in history, and it was just a mass of young people who were desperate to find some stability.
My mom would come home, all of a sudden she'd say, "This hippie's gonna be living with us for a while." And there'd be hippie on the couch for a while.
Here I was, moved down from Oregon, from Shiloh, and I was what I would call Oregon Mountain Woman. I did not fit into the Southern California scene, and I knew it, and I was just like so unhappy and didn't know what to do about it. So I began to pray, and God just said, "Look at Kay." And I looked at Kay, and here's this woman who was so beautiful on the inside, but she was so beautiful on the outside. I just loved it. And I loved her, and she loved me because she loved outsiders.
There was some issues about the long hair and the appearance coming in and influencing the children. That's when you got to see the lioness with Kay, and she said, "They will come. they are coming to church.
Kay was fascinated by these hippies. She was fascinated by the kids she would see walking by.
What's making them be that way? Why? Or there's something going on there. We got to figure it out. She had to investigate it. Why are they that way?
And that curiosity was because she wanted to understand them and she wanted to reach them with the gospel.
She would ask Chuck to drive her into Laguna Beach and down to the beach. She would pray for these kids.
I think she saw them as lost children and yet saw how they responded, because they were looking for love. And they did see Chuck as Papa Chuck.
And so you find someone who's older, who just accepts you the way that you are, and it's a powerful magnet. It's exactly what the kids were looking for, and they found it in Chuck and Kay both.
Watching God work in just marvelous ways in providing our needs. There would be many times that we wouldn't have money for dinner. Usually there would be a letter in the mail, and there would be a check or a $5 bill or $10 bill in the letter, and just over and over and over, so consistently.
He taught me trust in Him no matter what. In fact, this my life scripture is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge Him and He'll direct your path.
Kay really, to me, was almost like the heart and soul of Calvary Chapel.
She was a backbone, I think, to Chuck, and it was things that he couldn't do that she could do, so.
There's nothing that you could say about Kay that would make you doubt where she stood with the Lord.
Kay was very much attuned to the working of the Holy Spirit and gave great place to the moving of the Holy Spirit within her ministry.
She can unpack the Word of God and show how it applied to our everyday lives.
Through her teaching, you learned that you were more than enough. And through the difficulties, God's giving you compassion and strength and building a warrior in you.
And it's true, her teaching was really amazing. But her life came through in her teaching. And then when you talk to her, she was the same person. Her teaching wasn't a performance. It was just an expression of who she was.
She was just another person. And we look for rock stars in the church. I think Kay would be really upset if she knew we were all talking about her right now. That wouldn't be her at all. And Chuck was the same way.
You know, she met some very famous people in the Christian world and in the secular world, and yet she was such a lady. She had such dignity about her.
She was a daughter like a pillar, sculptured in palace style. And she did have an air of being regal. She was regal.
And she was comfortable with probably the highest of the high and the lowest of the low, both, and all of us in between.
She was open to be a friend. You could go up and talk to her, and she cared about what we were doing and enthused over everything.
I don't think we could ever think of Kay without thinking of how compassionate she was.
She felt what you felt. And that relieved you, because the burden got lighter because two were carrying it.
And she raised up women who could pray.
Yeah, I don't think you can just have a conversation with Kay and that doesn't turn into prayer.
In difficult times, you didn't want anybody to pray a nice, quiet prayer. You wanted Kay to pray for you because you knew heaven would come down and the answer would come forth.
She was intense. She was passionate. She was very persistent, and she was very perceptive.
She raised up so many to love and to know the Lord.
I think that desire to please the Lord was first and foremost in her heart and mind, and that's what made her that special, unique vessel that God could use, was that she was wholly devoted and committed to doing His will, His way.
Grandma Kay was the purest woman I've ever known. She was sweet and beautiful and kind, and she loved helping people. My favorite memory with her is when she asked Grandpa to start singing their love song, and he started singing it, she started singing along. It was just so beautiful and sweet that he teared up.
Our favorite memory or story about Great Grandma Kay is how good of a leader she was to the women's Bible study.
We love you,
Grandma Kay.
I will forever be grateful to the Lord for giving me the pleasure and the opportunity to know Kay
to work with her, to serve with her, to pray with her. We spent some fun times together because I loved her laughter, her sense of humor, and her transparency.
For a number of years, right after Friday morning Bible study, I would ask the Lord, "Lord, could you send me a best friend, someone older and wiser than me?" This went on for quite a while, till one day after Bible study, asking the Lord the same thing, He spoke right into my heart and said, "You have one. It's Kay. Oh, she may not know it, but she is." And I remember thinking, "Yes, she is my best friend. Thank you, Lord." I never asked the Lord again for a best friend. Kay was it.
My granddaughter Brittany is 3 years old. She's our eldest daughter's child. And Brittany was in a clothing store with her mama, one of the discount clothing stores. Just as they were ready to leave the sales checkout area, Brittany leveled that sales girl right in the eye. I mean, she just looked right at her, and she said, "Is it allowable to spit in this store? Is that naughty?" So Grandpa, anytime anything bothers him, now he says, "Is it allowable to spit in here?"
When I think back to my earliest memories of my grandma, I see long red nails and these bangle bracelets that she used to wear. She would usually let me wear a few, and I just felt so special every time I got to wear them. She was the most beautiful woman in the world. She loved black coffee and dark chocolate. Most of all, she loved people. She loved the people that others looked down on. I think the church can get it wrong sometimes and be unkind, but my grandma represented the love of Jesus in its most pure and true form. She was also bold and demanding and argumentative. She called out injustices and took action. She didn't make herself small, and she didn't get lost in my grandpa's shadow. She was her own beaming light, and I will forever love that about her.
We do celebrate with Kay that she's getting what she's hoped for all her life. She's always wanted to go be with Jesus, and now she is.
Kay is just basking in the glory. She doesn't have to worry about anybody anymore. It's all finished.
She's left a legacy in the lives of so many people, and the families of those people are looking to Jesus.
And she lived that out in front of us in such a dramatic way that I think that legacy is going to carry us forward into the next generations, because it is so powerful to have that in your life and to have experienced it through Kay.
She raised up so many to love and to know the Lord. And I have a lot of children, and I have 16 grandchildren, and I want them all to know Jesus, and that's what Kay wanted.
I think that, to me, she represents a whole person. And I think sometimes we want to isolate our heroes and saints and women of Scripture and put them as almost untouchable and unreachable. But Kay was a great model of just a love for her family, a love for the Lord, for the church. It's really important that we don't separate the saint that Kay was from the human being and the unique and beautiful woman that God made her to be in every sense of the word.
There was a lot of love there for the Lord and for His children. And she wore it well, and she showed it well. And I look forward to seeing her again.
These things are deeply ingrained in us by the way we were taught, by the way we were loved, by the way we were prayed for.
When you talk about what legacy has Kay Smith left for us, she would hate that question. And Kay would be the first one to tell you, you need to hear from the Holy Spirit as to what God wants you to do. You don't need to think, well, what would Kay do? She said, that'll get you into trouble. Her legacy would be, you do the best you can, you remain faithful, but but you have to move forward. It's your turn. Kay's legacy, I think, would be to hand the baton to the next generation and say, okay, it's yours now.
Oh, beloved sisters in Christ, you are so precious to me. I don't speak because I'm a great speaker. I'm not at all. I speak because through these years, I've found answers in God's word for my life and for the trials and the tests and the temptations, and they work. Put God to the test in these things. Know that He is a God who always triumphs.
When I was in high school, I found I had a secret power. My mom's friends would call to share their confidences. And if I didn't say it was me, they thought they were talking to her. And so I learned some things. So my mother insisted that from that point forward, I would answer the phone, Smith residence, Cheryl speaking. I want to read these excerpts from some of the things that my mom shared with the Joyful Life Bible study. So this is Kay Smith in her own words. I was adopted as an infant, and over the years, I've thought so many times of what could have happened to me had God not placed me in a Christian home. My life would have been completely different, but He had a plan for me. And that plan was for my life to bring Him pleasure. What an amazing thought. I was made for God's pleasure. My mother decided to open her home to minister to babies and little children when their own parents couldn't keep them. She thought, oh, what an opportunity to pray over each baby, each little child. My biological mother dropped me off one day and just never came back. My parents had brought me up in the things of the Lord. I had the sweetest earthly father possible. Daddy and I were very close. He was the one I went to when I needed a heart-to-heart talk. When I was 13, they bought a ranch, and we would visit on the weekends. At first, we still attended church very regularly. We'd drive out to the ranch on Saturday morning, stay all day, but come back Saturday night so we could be in church on Sunday. Of course, it wasn't too long before we began going up and staying the entire weekend and missing church altogether. For 7 years, that was our lifestyle. At 18, I started college, and that's all I needed to push me over the edge. My teachers all embraced humanistic philosophies. As they would stand before our class laughing at God and tearing down the things of God, I'd think, they're right. There's nothing to Christianity. I remember visiting a church around that time and just crying because I wanted to believe so badly, but I just couldn't get past my parents' lifestyle. All the things they had always taught me to be evil, they were now doing. When I was 20, we were involved in a horrible, horrible accident on the way home. I believe God permitted that accident as a wake-up call. It was His chastening hand upon my parents because they completely crowded Him out of their lives. I had only been back with the Lord 9 months when I met the man who would become my husband. I had just come out of college and dated a few of the boys I knew there, but I'd never met anyone before who compared with Chuck Smith. On our first date, he talked about the sermon he was planning to teach in Santa Barbara that coming weekend. I fell for him right then and there. I listened to him and thought, at last, a godly man. Neither of us really wanted to get married, and we made our feelings about that clear to each other on our second date. On our third date, Chuck asked me to marry him. And I did, just 2 months after we had met. We've been in ministry together just as long as we've been married, because Chuck took his first pastorate within weeks of our marriage. And let me tell you, I was woefully aware of my own inadequacy on that first day of my new position as wife of the pastor. I was excited, naturally, and curious about what was to come, but I didn't have any idea what I was supposed to do as a pastor's wife. I sure knew what they looked like, though. They were kind of severe, and they dressed just right. And of course, their every movement was marvelous, perfect, and godly. So I was a bit daunted, because I knew I didn't have any of that going for me. All I had was a little bravery. Our first church was a small congregation in Prescott, Arizona. Chuck and I were barely 21, and the first thing I noticed when we walked in that Sunday morning was that almost everyone in the room was over 50. Before I could let that information really sink in, a lady walked up to me and said, "I am the adult Sunday school class teacher." Then she handed me her quarterly and added, "And now you are." How's that for an introduction to ministry? I had never taught a Sunday school class in my life. I hadn't even read through the entire Bible. I'd only been back with the Lord for 9 months and married for only 3 weeks. In the beginning of our ministry, we used to love helping people so much that Chuck actually put an ad in the newspaper saying, "If you need counseling, come to us." It included our home phone number. I used to call people to ask, "How are you doing?" hoping they weren't doing well so I could then tell them how to live. I was 22 years old and had 2 years of psychology under my belt, and I thought I had all the answers. Now I think, "Oh Lord, unless you give it to me, I don't have answers for anybody." But He is always faithful to provide what I need. I simply waited on the Lord and did what seemed to come most naturally. I tried to be conscientious in my dress, and I loved the people. I still love them to this day. There was something so homespun and sweet about them. The whole thing was an experience and joy. I can hardly remember anything that went wrong. I think that's a gift from God. It isn't that things didn't go wrong. They did. But there was something about being in the ministry and being a pastor's wife that I love so deeply. I always have, and I still do. Chuck and I have learned to walk in brokenness with each other, and it has made all the difference in our marriage. Whenever we have to be apart, whether he's flying off to another country or we're just leaving each other for the day, we like to leave little notes for each other. He calls me Casey, and I call him Captain Zoom Zoom. Because he's always zooming everywhere. Isn't that the most romantic name you've ever heard? But he's my dear Captain Zoom Zoom. Chuck and I first went to London in the early 70s, and then we went quite regularly. We've been all over England, but the very first time we went, I felt an intense burden for the country, especially for London. That burden just grew and grew with every visit to England. Chuck would be at one of the pastors' conferences with all the men, while I'd stay in our room and cry out to God for London, asking Him to send someone to reach them. I don't know how I've been thrown under the bus at my mom's celebration, but... So when Cheryl and Brian told us what God was asking them to do, I said through tears, "I have prayed for England for so many years. I have yearned for their salvation. I just didn't know what the cost would be." When we arrived at the airport and began to say our goodbyes, we were, of course, crying and hugging each other. I stood watching them disappear through the door, and I thought, oh, how grateful I am that my bundle of love that just got on the plane loves Jesus, all of them. And they've got a better solution by far, and so have we. Amen. Oh.
You know, from the moment when Kay passed, I was in Europe at the time, and Cheryl and Chuck had been with her the week before, and it was more or less anticipated that it wouldn't be long. And from the moment that I heard that she had passed, I was relieved. And I was rejoicing with her, and I found myself, I was alone, I was quarantined in my room in England, and I found that I was thinking about what it must have been like for that moment, for her, for all of her life, from the time she was 20 years old, loving, following, serving Jesus, to now emerge out of the illness and all that she'd been living through for these past several years into the presence of Jesus. So all that to say, I haven't had any sad emotion at all. I've just rejoiced with her. And I haven't had any sad emotion today, but I've really been touched by all of the stories. And of course, you know, knowing many of those stories myself. But Cheryl and I, we traveled extensively with Chuck and Kay. We spent a lot of our lives with them, especially in the years when we lived down in Vista. Tuesday was Chuck's day off, and every Tuesday, Grandma and Grandpa were there, you know, to see the kids, to spend the day. Cheryl and Kay would end up at the mall, and Chuck and I would end up with the kids at Toys R Us or Chuck E. Cheese or, you know, wherever. And you know, he was just so amazing as a grandpa like that. But in all of our, you know, traveling together and driving around together and just all the times that we spent together, there were so many moments that were absolutely humorous. And you know, anybody who knows Cheryl knows that Cheryl is very much like her mother. And I mean, sometimes, you know, we're in the midst of something and I will just call her Kate. It's like, okay, Kate, because, you know, she's just being her mother at that moment. But, and you know, Kay was, she was definitely a backseat driver, and she always wanted to give Chuck instruction on, you know, how to get there and when to stop and when to start and when to go. Cheryl does all of those things. And, but one day we were driving, and we ended up talking about something, and people were driving recklessly or something like that, and I said something like, well, you know, and, you know, Cheryl, of course, she knows that they're all on drugs, and that's why they're doing that, and she knows all these details about their life, you know, and Chuck's listening, and when I finished, he said, well, I can do you one better than that. Kay not only knows they're on drugs, he knows the kind of drug, or she knows the kind of drug that they're on. So I said, okay, well, you beat me on that one, because, but my my memories of Kay, what I was thinking about just a couple of words to sum her up, and classy would be probably one of the first words I would think of. She was just extremely classy. And another word would be brilliant. She was a very bright person. And she loved learning, and she loved to know things, and she, you know, she was curious about so many things, and she did know numbers of things. And like Greg said, I had many long, long conversations with her on the phone. And we had a really wonderful relationship all of our lives. But one final thing I would say is that when I was really young and here on staff, there was an elderly woman who was probably about 80 at the time, and I was in my 20s. And somehow, I don't even remember the details of how I got connected with her, but she referred to me as Reverend Bryant. And Kay found out about that, and she just thought that that was the most adorable and sort of the funniest thing, that I would be called Reverend Bryant. So on these certain occasions, it just at the right moment, she would look at me and say, well, Reverend Bryant, what do you think? So she just, you know, adopted that. And I mean, almost all the way, you know, through her life, she would occasionally go back to that. So, but personally, I'm just so thankful to have had so many opportunities to be with her and to know her and to enjoy her as a person. And the final thing, beside classy and brilliant, and of course, she was godly. She loved Jesus intensely, and I was the recipient of some of those intense prayers, and I heard some of those prayers also toward other people, and yes, indeed, she could pray.
One day, my dad came home from the Calvary that was on Greenville and Sunflower, and he said, Kay, somebody shot out all the windows. And I'll just tell you, I don't want to be that person. Once I heard my mom start praying, their teeth broke in their mouth. They went to jail for life. And then they went to hell in a handbasket. I just didn't want to be them. My mom is what I would call a reactor. She reacted to things, and she hated that about herself. She absolutely hated that she reacted. My brothers took a little bit of advantage of that. They loved to hear her scream. And I remember, sorry, Chuck, but I remember you jumping off the balcony at 731 St. James Road, and my mom just started screaming. She was sure Chuck was dead, and he peeked over the balcony and said, "Gotcha." And I wouldn't have wanted to be him at that moment either. But her lifelong struggle was to become a responder rather than a reactor. And she reacted as a mother quite a bit to all of us. But she would take that reaction to the throne of God, and she would come back to us as a responder. And one of the things I appreciated is that my mom would say she was sorry with all the sincerity that she had in her heart, and she meant it. And she was one of those people who wanted to be so much more than what she was. It was never enough to just be Kay. She never felt like she prayed intensely enough. She never felt like she told you she loved you enough. She never felt like she affirmed you enough. She never felt like anything she did, whether she played the piano, that it was good enough. Nothing in her life did she ever feel like she measured up. And I just think that wonderful perfectionist is now perfect in the presence of Jesus Christ. Now, my mom loved to call herself an initiator. And so I remember one of those times that we were at the mall, there was a man that was reading a Ron Hubbard's book. And my mother, we were having coffee, and my mother kept looking over at him. And he would look back at her, and she'd be like, and he said, finally, "May I help you?" And she said, "Oh, no, not really, but my daughter wants to tell you all about Jesus Christ. And I'm going to leave her here with you, and I'm just going to walk around." And he looked at me, and he said, "Yes?" And I'm like, "Hi." And so later, when I joined my mom, she said, "Do you know, Cheryl, you just don't witness enough. You just don't. I've noticed this, just this apprehension about, and I'm sorry, honey, but you needed that. And go over to that sales girl right there, because I told her that you had something to say to her." Another time we were walking in the mall, and she was intrepid. And every time I would get afraid, she would say, "Cheryl, I was born in L.A. And that seemed to be the answer to everything. She was born in L.A., so she did not have fear. One time we were at the Damascus Gate. We had left the rest of the group where my dad is, feeling no fear, feeling actually nothing. That was kind of my dad. He just didn't feel. My mom had all the feelings. And my dad was always great. My mom felt the pain. You know, you kicked Chuck, she felt it. And he just said, "Great." But I remember being at the Damascus Gate, and my mom said, "Cheryl, I was born in L.A. There was a riot at the Damascus Gate. And the U.N. soldiers started pouring through the gate. And there were these, you know, it was a riot. They're coming out. Everyone, you could feel it in the crowd." And I said, "Mom, we need to get out of here." She said, "Cheryl, just stay behind the CNN crew." Because they were there filming. And so my mom just, she brings me in and herself, and we're behind the CNN, you know, guys that are filming this whole thing. And I'm like, "Mom, this is, Cheryl, I was born in L.A. I'm like, "I know, but Mom." And then all of a sudden, a tear gas bomb dropped in the middle of the crowd. You know that, and she turns to me, she goes, "Run." I'm running after her, watching her red jacket go through the Damascus gates as they close. And there I am. And I'm smashed up against the wall, and I make my way to a UN soldier, and I said, "I am an American. I need help." And he said, "Just a minute." And he takes me back where these guys are just drinking Turkish coffee and sitting down, and I'm like, "Oh, okay, so just a little ways away, and all of a sudden, two UN soldiers come in and go, Cheryl, Cheryl Brotherson, where's Cheryl? And there's my mom, that's her, right there, right there. She had gone and gotten the UN soldiers to come in and save me, and she didn't let them go alone. She came with them. Another time, because my mom was hilarious. She had a great sense of humor. We were doing the pastor's wives routine. She said, Cheryl, they're doing one of those panels. Do you like those panels? And I said, no, Mom, I am so uncomfortable on those panels. She goes, me too. Let's make up our own questions and see what the other girls do with them. So my mom says, write this, because they'll recognize my handwriting. Who is the Leviathan mentioned in the book of Job? And how does that relate to being a pastor's wife? She was a rascal, and she knew how to have fun. And she brought that element. Every Christmas, my mother had these presents that were jokes? Or they were just like, I remember the year Chuck Jr. got Catherine Coleman's weights. I know, you wonder what that looked like. It was interesting. But my mom would pull out these things and say, the person who has this will be blessed by God, and the mantle of Catherine Coleman will fall. And, you know, one year we had this angel that someone had given my dad. It was a naked, I hope it wasn't you. It was a naked angel made out of bread dough. And it was pretty ugly. And so my mom decided that she would give it each year to one of us. You never knew who that recipient was going to be. And every year it was missing a limb until it was just a torso that was going from family to family. There was this wonderful side of her. If she was playing a game with the family, she shouted out all the answers. Or if you were winning, she threw the board across the room. You remember? She was magical, and she was wonderful, and she was also terrifying. And she's the reason I never wanted to disobey Jesus or walk away from Jesus. And my teeth are still intact. I'll end with this story before I read my daughter's description of their grandmother. But one time we were at the mall down in Vista, and she had taken me over to this dark corner. And I said, Mom, nobody's supposed to be over here. This is not a good place. And again, Cheryl, I was born in LA. And so a sketchy person was walking, and, you know, again, my mom had been the pastor's wife to the hippies, so she was not afraid. So she looked at him and she said, hello there. And he looked at her and he said, wow, most people won't talk to me. And my mom said, well, why is that? Well, I just got out of prison. And I'm like, Mom, let's go. Sure. I was born in LA. Well, what were you in prison for?
Murder.
And she said, no wonder no one wants to talk to you. You shouldn't murder anyone. Cheryl, come on.
Wait, there's one classic story that you should tell. We were just in Santa Barbara a couple days ago, and every time we're in Santa Barbara, Cheryl's reminded of this story. And we were there a couple days ago with our oldest daughter, Kristen, and you showed us the place where the tree was, where your mother had another encounter with interesting person.
My first day of college was the next day, and my parents had come up with my sister and brother-in-law and niece, Caitlin, to see me off for college. It was a family event. I was going to be living at Westmont College. And so we were eating at the Good Earth, and we came out, and there was a homeless man, and he was holding a typewriter. And he said, you want to buy a typewriter? And my mom said, you don't own that. And I'm thinking, do not talk to this man. Do not talk to this man. I've got to get to my college. This is stressful. But my mom engaged him in conversation. Yes, I did. I found it. My mom said, you did not find that. You stole that. And he said, nope, I found it. And she said, where? And he said, in a tree. And my mom said, show me. And so he says, down here. So there we are, following a homeless man through the streets of Santa Barbara on the day before my first day of college. You all thought she was so normal. Life really was a continual adventure. He did take us to the tree. He pointed to the branch where he found the typewriter, and she said, you are not telling the truth. You need to receive Jesus, and then he will help you tell the truth. And he said, okay. And so my mom and dad prayed for him, and then we left, and that was pretty much the story. Any boy that I brought home from school, I'll just bring this. She'd be like, you go to church? Where? How many times? I mean, they were grilled. Brian was able to answer, yes, Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa. Chuck is my pastor, so he passed. This is my daughter, Kristen Smith. She married Michael Smith. So she got the name Smith back. But she wrote this. My grandmother was an extraordinary person. She had a deep tenderness and was probably the most empathetic person I have ever known. I made a precious discovery some time ago when I picked up an old book of hers and found several handwritten letters from a young man who had just become a Christian. He actually ended up becoming a close family friend. But at the time of letter writing, he was unknown to our family. His mother suffered from MS, and he had reached out to my grandmother just to let her know how much her ministry had blessed him as he went through this season. This initial letter led to a sweet and encouraging correspondence between the two of them. And 30 years later, the letters were still with her. I actually shared them with that very friend. He had even included a hilarious little yearbook picture of himself. We all teared up as we talked about the way she acknowledged and encouraged all people, believing that every person was worth her time and attention. My grandmother was also the first person I ever knew who sponsored children. She had the pictures on her nightstand so she could pray for them daily, and she'd show me their images and take me through each child's name and story. Each one was so unique and dear to her. These are just a few examples of the kind of woman she was. There are many more. She was loving, she was caring, she was authentic, and she was someone who could never turn away from a sincere soul, especially one seeking after her wonderful Savior. This is from my daughter, Kelsey. Those brave girls. My grandmother, to me, was always grace and perfection. She added elegance and precision to everything she did, from her delicate but powerful strike of a piano chord to the way she methodically applied her lipstick. It took many years for me to realize my grandmother was a mere mortal. To me, she was the gracious queen out of a fairy tale, beautiful and elegant, but filled with compassion and tenderness to those in need. As I grew up, I saw that although she was perfect to me, she was very aware of her own shortcomings and humanity. But in her weakness and vulnerability, she threw herself even deeper into the arms of her Savior, and it lent to a heart that was deeply compassionate and caring for anyone in need. How quickly she turned a conversation to prayer, how heartfelt she sang a hymn. Her identity was rooted in Jesus. There are so many ways in which I hope to emulate my grandma, but most of all, I hope to cling to my Savior the way she did, and I am so sure she is doing this now and forever. My mom entered heaven on August 13th, 2021, and there she found her cohorts, Betty Willems and Carolyn Lamb, her prayer partners. She saw my dad, and he looked just like Captain Zoom Zoom. She saw her beloved sister, my Aunt Isi. She saw her mother and father, whom she loved and missed. She's in glory, and I can't wait to see her.
Oh, family is, of course, very important. When I proposed to Kay. I told her that I wasn't looking for an assistant pastor. I was looking for a mother, that I wanted a family. I wanted children, because I've loved children, always have loved children. And that I wanted a mother who would raise our children. And of course, she was very faithful in that. And once the children were raised, then she felt the liberty to begin a ministry herself to the women of the church, using Paul's exhortation to Titus that the older women should teach the younger women the basic, how to be a wife, how to be a godly mother, and how to take care of their families and all.
Chuck, how much has Kay's support meant to your ministry?
Oh, without her support, it would never have been what it has become. So it's just a real blessing.
So quite a few people just talked about Kay's legacy and just so many aspects of her. And even though she was very classy, as been mentioned, she also was very funny. And I know that that's been mentioned as well. But I was reminded, as the stories were being told, of one time when we were living in England, and my mom had decided to book us a high tea at Harrods. And this is a very classy event. But they decided to bring me. And at that time, I wore a baseball cap constantly and had terrible hair. And so we got to the event. My mom had coached me beforehand, you know, this is what you have to do, and you have to be nice and proper and sit up, and you can't burp and all these things. And I think she was really coaching me, like, don't embarrass grandma. Grandma's really classy. And so we got there, and she kept on kind of, like, looking at me and giving me, like, the eye, like, don't do it. And my grandma's kind of confused as to what's going on. And then she's like, take off your hat. So I take off my hat, and I set it on the table, and my hair is just wild. You know, and my mom's like, put on your hat. And so I put on my hat, and I'm doing everything wrong. I'm spilling things. I'm trying to be as proper as I possibly can. And my grandma just starts giggling, and she can't hold it in. And all of a sudden, she's just throwing her head back, laughing in the middle of Harrods. And we all just start dying laughing because I was just such a scene, such an embarrassment. So she just loved to have a good time, and she loved to laugh. And for many of you, you know, she loved to sing. She loved to sing, and Hannah Colt was actually reminding me, I think it was yesterday, the day before, she said, was it your mom or was it Kay that would make the women sing, go out with joy and be led forth in peace after every joyful life? I said, that was definitely my grandma. And she just loved to sing. She had a piano in her house, and she loved to sit down and play, and she loved to sing the hymns. And so we've been just talking about her legacy, talking about her life, and so just wanted to honor her by singing one of her favorite hymns and just being reminded she loved to talk about Jesus. I can even hear the way she would say his name in my head when I think about her. Jesus was a close friend of hers that walked with her, that talked with her, and now she is truly walking and talking with him.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other is ever known. The sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other is ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joys we share as we tarry there, none other is ever.
Will you please stand up? Okay, you can sit down now. Please, and you know why? My dad always said, the mind cannot retain more than the seat can endure. Almost 30 years ago, I asked Dad if my son Mike and I could join him on his Israel tour that year, and he said, sure. So a few weeks later, we were there. And one morning, someone found me on the bus and said, your dad wants you. And so I made my way down the aisle to the front of the bus, and he said, Chuck, we're on our way to Shiloh, and I'd like for you to speak there. I had never been to Shiloh, and I didn't know what to expect, but I immediately thought of Jeremiah chapter 7, one of my favorite passages. And I turned to return to my seat, and my mom said, remember Hannah? And instead of Jeremiah, I real quickly turned to the first couple of chapters of First Samuel. And it tells the story of Elkanah, who had two wives. The name of one was Hannah, and the other was Hananah. And Hannah had no children. Hananah, however, had children. She had sons and daughters. This man went up from his city yearly to worship and sacrifice to the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. Also, the two sons of Eli were there. And whenever the time came for Elkanah to make an offering, he would give portions to Peninnah, his wife, and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he would give a double portion, for he loved Hannah, although the Lord had closed her womb. And her rival also provoked her severely to make her miserable because the Lord had closed her womb. So it was year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, that she provoked her. Therefore, Hannah wept and did not eat. Then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you than 10 sons? So Hannah arose after they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh. Now, Eli the priest was sitting by the seat of the doorpost of the tabernacle of the Lord. And she was in bitterness of soul and prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Then she made a vow and said, O Lord of hosts,
if you will indeed look upon the affliction of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but will give your maidservant a male child, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head. And it happened, as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli watched her mouth. Now, Hannah spoke in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli thought she was drunk. Eli said to her, "How long will you be drunk? Put your wine away from you, Debbie and Ernie." But Hannah answered and said, "No, my Lord, I am a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor intoxicating drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Do not consider your maidservant a wicked woman, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken now." Then Eli answered and said, "Go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition which you have asked of him." And she said, "Let your maidservant find favor in your sight." So the woman went her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad. In honoring my mother today, I am going to remember Hannah. Mom journeyed with all of the important women in the Bible, especially those who found God's grace in hardship. I think that it's possible Mom felt a special connection to Hannah, that it was, you know, it's not just because she knew of Hannah's story there in Shiloh, but I think that she could relate to Hannah. Mom had experienced bitterness of soul and anguish. She knew the emotional state of Hannah. In fact, I inherited my mom's melancholy temperament. Dad, however, never knew a day of depression in his life. He knew sadness, he knew bitter grief, but it never lasted long with Dad. Dad was a born optimist. Mom and I were realists. Dad could immediately dismiss negative thoughts. He could encourage himself. You know, Dad would say, "Chuck, we need to give people the perspective of the eternal. The perspective of the temporal, of right now, it doesn't make sense. Life doesn't make sense. And we get all caught up in that. But if people see the perspective of the eternal, all this other stuff just fades away." And he really could encourage himself with a thought like that, and a verse like that, and not stay down. Well, beginning probably in junior high school, but especially as a junior in high school, I had the onset of a major depression that lasted like 40 years. It was typically, like a mild state of depression. What do you say when a low-grade depression, that was it, with occasional flare-ups of clinical depression. But around 17 or 18, you know, Dad saw it. He had no idea what to do with it. And he said, "You know, Chuck, if you're down all the time, you're not going to have many friends." And I wanted to say, "Wow, Dad, that changes everything. I want friends." So one time in a sermon, I happened to say that my prayer in life was, "Please, Lord, more like Dad, less like Mom." And that got back to Mom. There's just a lot of tattletales around, but my whole life. But Mom would tease me with that. She'd say, "I heard that you said more like Dad, less like Mom." And I, "Mom, let me explain it." She just kind of laughed. But she did this all the time. I heard you say, more like Dad, less like Mom. And I told her, no, Mom, that was Jeff who said that. One day, reading 1 Samuel, it occurred to me, Dad is Elkanah. It makes total sense. Elkanah doesn't get his wife at all. What's with this sadness? What's with this grief? Am I not better to you than 10 sons? Doesn't that change everything? But not to a woman whose the trajectory of her whole life has been family, to give her husband an heir, to give him children. And that there's some sense of failure, some sense of wrongness with her own body, her own self. She can't do this for him. And some loss of meaning in her life. And yes, my dear, you're a wonderful provider. You are better than 10 sons, but I'd settle for one if it would bring me that fulfillment that I'm missing in my life. And my dad did not know what to do with Mom's moods. So I taught Bible studies every night. Look, my dad didn't get it because God did not want him to get it. If my dad parked over every heartache in his life, he would have never done the work for God that God had for him. He had to be the man he was. Even if he did not fully understand the woman that God gave him to be at his side. Others of us, unlike my dad, are allowed to know depression. Unfortunately, many Christians who experience it feel like they're failed Christians. And I'd like to tell you, you're not. In fact, I found it consoling that one of my favorite preachers, Charles Spurgeon, wrote this: knowing by most painful experience what deep depression of spirit means, being visited therewith at seasons by no means few or far between, I thought it might be consolatory to some of my brethren if I gave my thoughts thereon. The younger men might not fancy that some strange thing had happened to them when they became for a season possessed by melancholy, and that sadder men might know that one upon whom the sun has shone right joyously did not always walk in the light. He talks about feeling down for no good reason, and that's depression. I mean, when you're sad, you typically have a reason. When you grieve, you have a reason. But depression, sometimes you just can't locate what's causing it. He says, causeless depression is not to be reasoned with, nor can David's harp charm it away by sweet conversation. As well fight with the mist as with this shapeless, undefinable, yet all-beclouding hopelessness. If those who laugh at such melancholy did but feel the grief of it for 1 hour, their laughter would be sobered by compassion. A woman one time was telling me about the death of her mother, and she said, the grief is worse than I knew it would be. You know, sometimes you don't know how deep your soul goes until you experience severe grief. You feel you can't breathe. And she said, I don't think I can go on living with this kind of pain. So I explained to her what I knew, and I said, it won't always be this kind of pain. There will be waves. And there will be moments when you laugh again. And what will happen is the waves will even out with time, and your body and your mind will become used to the pain. And once you become used to the pain, there will be changes. And what feels bitter and breaks your heart now will become sweet to you as you remember. And somewhat consoled, she said, "Thank you. That helps, I think." I said, "Think about this. Suppose this kind of pain never left you. There was no hope of it going away, that you woke up under this dark cloud every day of your life." And her eyes got big as she realized that. She said, "That would be hell." I said, "That is depression. Many people don't know that. They don't understand that." My mom did. I did not know this aspect of my mom. I'm going to share some things discreetly, but unlike what you've heard about my mom today. One day we had an intense heart to heart. I was trying to make sense of my own childhood and adolescence. Mom told me that when I was a small child, I was the happiest child on earth. She said something happened when I was elementary school age, and I became morose. And she said, "I've never been able to figure that out." So one day we're talking, she said, "Is there anything that you need?" Because I was going through a tough time. I said, "No, I'm good." And she said, "Anything at all?" And I said, "Well, okay, I'd like to ask you a question. And it's personal, so you don't have to answer, but if you answer, answer honestly." And she said, "Okay." She wasn't enthused about divulging her upbringing to me, but she did want to help, so she opened up. And she told me stories I had never heard. I knew that she was adopted, that her adopted mother was a nurse, that her dad was an accountant, and that her mother used her strings as a nurse to adopt her when she became available. And all I'm going to say about her mom is that she abused my mother in bizarre ways. The stories my mom told were hair-raising and tragic. And as a result, my mom lived terrified of setting her mother off. And she lived in that terror the whole time she lived at home. What mom did not know growing up was that her mother was not normal. She was not a normally mentally healthy person. Mom had a sister about 20 years older than her, and one day they were having a conversation, and her sister said to her, "Well, Mom was schizophrenic, you know." My mom was in her 50s when she learned this. She had no clue as to how to understand her mom, and like most children, she carried the burden of her mom's bizarre behavior. "It's my fault. I'm a bad girl. I'm not trying hard enough." When Cheryl talked about mom never feeling good enough, she came by that honestly. She was given that impression her entire life. "It's all your fault that her mom is behaving this way." Until then, she never fully understood her mom's irrational behavior. Now, because you love my mom, I want you to know this. that she experienced a life of suffering from her childhood on, and that her suffering became internalized in her patterns of thinking, her dark moods that visited her often, that she struggled with acute anxiety and depression. I remember days when she did not get out of bed for the entire day. I remember evenings when right after dinner, she went to bed unhappy and we did not see her for the rest of the night. When I heard from my older sister Jeanette and my younger brother Jeff that Mom had passed, I immediately felt a sense of deep sadness. And it wasn't grief, I know grief. I had lost my mom months before she passed away. You understand that if you've had a parent or a friend with dementia. And her death was a release from a body that could not contain a life so brilliant and vibrant. My dad would say she moved out of her earthly tent into her heavenly building. No, it wasn't grief. I felt sad for the little girl whose life was so painfully hard and who carried that hardness of life into adulthood and all the way through. Of course, Mom had many bright memories. God did plant good in her life. The brightest for her was knowing Jesus from a young age. Her love for Jesus was fed to her by her older sister, as Cheryl said, our Aunt Isi, who my dad described as a magical woman. Imagine my dad using a term like magical. But he said Isi was a magical woman because when she came, everything brightened up. She really was a source of hope for Mom. And Mom loved every visit and every conversation she had with her sister. My Aunt Isi, by the way, some Calvary Chapel pastors may not like this, she was the senior pastor of the First Foursquare Church in Phoenix, Arizona. And my dad adored her and felt that her partner, Mary Jane May, was a very gifted preacher, and he enjoyed listening to her preach. Dirty little secrets of Calvary Chapel. Okay, so Mom's love for Jesus was also nurtured by the church of her youth. And there she learned the Bible from this most flamboyant woman preacher, Amy Semple McPherson, who would would script and produce plays based on the Bible, also musicals. She was there before Debbie and Ernie were, you know, doing this kind of thing, or Pete and Hanukkah, and not just Bible stories. She made the Bible come alive on stage. Angelus Temple was built like a theater with a big proscenium arch and a big staging area. One of my mom's favorite memories was seeing Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. And each of the dwarfs was some spiritual lesson that Amy Semple McPherson brought out. If you ever heard a sermon by Amy Semple or read it, Sister Amy, it's very flowery, very over the top. Okay, so later on, Mom played the clarinet in the church orchestra there. And later on, she was a secretary in the office there. In fact, I remember as a small child going up there with my mom, and I'd go across the street into Echo Park, I think it was, and feed the ducks. She was held by God through her life. Other bright memories that she had were of her father. She adored her father. Cheryl said that was the close connection in that family. And she would tell me stories. Every once in a while, my mom and dad's caregiver would want some time off, and she'd call me and she'd say, can you come spend the weekend? Can you come and be here Thursday night so I can go to Bible study? Can you spend a week here while I'm gone visiting family? And so I took those opportunities to be with my parents, make sure they both had their medications, that my dad's open sore was, you know, being treated, that, you know, all the stuff that a caregiver does. And my mom, after dad would be off to work, would I'd get her breakfast, and then she would tell me stories. And typically the same story again and again, but that were there in the well of her soul. And she'd tell me stories about her dad, like when he was an accountant for the Doheny family in Beverly Hills and took her with him to visit the mansion there, and oh, Chuck, you should have seen it. And then her wedding day. Mom woke up on her wedding day, opened her eyes, and there was her father sitting on the floor, staring at her in bed. And she said, Daddy, what are you doing? And he said, I just want one last look at my little girl before she goes off with him. It was so precious to her. That same day, God gave Mom a gift that he'd been saving for her. My dad, he was her hero. He was her knight in shining armor. He saved her from the tower where she had been imprisoned. Dad was her rock, a stable center in the midst of a chaotic world. And she always came back to that center for consolation and solace, as well as perspective. You know, some people who suffer give up on God. Not Mom. Her pain did not turn her away from God. It drove her to him. Suffering can do that, you know. Suffering can energize prayers. Luke tells us that Jesus in the garden, being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. A familiar sight for me was to get up in the morning and head into the kitchen and see my mom in the family room sitting on the couch with a Bible open on her lap and her bent over it, praying. There's just a sense of the sacred about that in my mind. It was a familiar sight, and I knew what was going on. It was incredibly private. It's like when she wrote in her journal in shorthand so that it was just between her and God. No one else could, you know, could spy on that. That was her private moment. She could pray, but whatever she prayed in public, the seeds of it were in her private prayer time. She would say to me in the time that I spent with her caregiving, she'd say, you know, I gave the ministry of the women's ministry at Calvary Chapel to Cheryl because I just noticed that the younger women, you know, had issues and needed help that related directly to them, and that Cheryl could do a better job. She says, but now I'm not raising children. I don't have a ministry. And I keep asking God, why am I still here? What is it that I can be doing? And she said, I realize it's to be praying for my children and my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren. And then there are others who would come to mind, and whenever anyone came along into her mind, well, they got in the crosshairs of her prayers also. I'm sharing my mother with you in this way because this beautiful woman that you saw, graceful and brilliant, And when you heard her teach scriptures with passion and sincerity, when you observed this faithful pastor's wife who for years played the piano and the organ, she would play the piano and my dad would sing solos, sometimes duets. She would not sing. This woman who taught Sunday school and led the choir, you would not know that behind this lovely persona was a bird with a broken wing who struggled every day to overcome her disabilities. You know, when you are struggling and you try to share it, another person will often say, I understand. And you know they don't. It's the look in the eyes, it's the tone of voice. Or if you have known depression and you try to explain that to someone and they say, I understand, I've been disappointed too. I've thought a lot about that regarding Jesus, who in the garden suffered agony. When he looks into your eyes and he says, I understand, you know he's been there. You know that he really does understand. If you ever shared your heartache with my mom, I know you shared lovely stories with her. God did this for you. He answered that prayer for you. But if you ever shared a heartache with my mom, then you know how she instantly reacted, that her face tightened into pure compassion and concern. You could see it in her eyes. She might even have drawn a quick breath, like, that she's shocked, she's horrified to hear that you've suffered such a blow. And her vocal intonation would resonate with concern. Many times when mom was on the phone, and she'd pray on the phone. I mean, those of you who said, yeah, an hour conversation with my mom on the phone, an hour and a half, I'm sure some of that was prayer. And she could pray long prayers on the phone. It's like, okay, mom. But impassioned prayers. I mean, there was such fervency in her prayers. I mean, I just got the impression the Lord was in trouble if he did not do it, she said. Many times I heard her weep when she prayed with people on the phone. If my mom made you feel special, here's the reason. That you knew when you talked to her, she connected with you. You felt heard. You felt that she felt your pain. My mom was like pure empathy embodied in this delicate person. To the wounded soul, that kind of response means everything. If my mom knew Hannah's sorrow, she also knew Hannah's triumph. You know that Hannah wrote a psalm, and part of it is quoted later on in the Psalms? She left the old priest Eli that day transformed. Mom would have been the last person in the world I would have pegged for a ministry called Joyful Life. But that is what she always looked for in the scripture and believed was there, and believed that she had it in a transcendent way, if not in the life of her mind and body. And that's what she wanted to give to you. She wanted to guarantee to the women of her ministry a joyful life greater than what she had ever known herself. because she knew it was possible. She knew that there was light after darkness, that there was a waking up to Jesus in the midst of sorrow that enabled her to keep on going. As intense as Mom's hardships and heartaches were, they did not break her. But by God's grace, all that agony is what made her wonderful.
By the blood of Jesus Christ, He has given us atonement for our sins, and the love gift sacrifice. Now let's sing to the one who called I am, as we praise His holy land, as we lift our hands in this holy place, in the holy place where we enter in by the blood of Jesus Christ. He has given us atonement for our sins, and the love gift sacrifice. Now let's sing to the one who's called I am, as we praise His holy land, as we lift our hands in this holy place. sing to the Father with words of praise, counting us worthy to bear his name. Sing to the Father with words of love, filled with his spirit of life from above.
I just want to thank the family for allowing me to sing. I was with, I think, six other women for Joyful Life services for several years, and we led the worship before Kay would speak. And there's one thing that I remember a lot of things, but one thing that sticks out in my mind that she said one day that actually almost affects my life every single day. That is, one day she came out, and she said, you know, I just don't like how people use the word awesome so casually. She said, we shouldn't use that word for anything else but God. God is awesome. So for years, I never would even use that word. And then, you know, it kind of became more prevalent, and I catch myself, everyone's going, oh, that's awesome. I'm going, oh, nope, it's not awesome. God is awesome, and only he is awesome, so... I'd like you to stand and sing this next song with us.
Oh, Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And that once burned bright and clear, renew the lamp of my first love that burns with holy fear. Thank you. child. Your grace abounds to me.
We want to thank you so much for joining us for the celebration of life of my grandma, Kay Smith. And just as we continue to spend time together in the courtyard, we just have a few things. And I would just encourage you to share your story with one another as we fellowship together. But we just have a few things in the courtyard. These are some things that were my grandma's favorite. Now, she considered herself a coffee snob, but she loved U-Ban coffee. So we have U-Ban coffee. And she loved See's candy, and she loved to cut them up, and she savored every bite. So we have some See's candy for you. And we've got some vanilla ice cream and chocolate fudge to go on top because she loved a sundae. And then also, one of her favorite things to eat was an In-N-Out cheeseburger. And so we have an In-N-Out truck. It's out there waiting. Yeah, and so we just invite you guys to spend time together, fellowshipping. I imagine there's a lot of catching up to do with our Calvary Chapel family here today. So, but as you leave, we have a guest book. We would love you to sign it. And also, we have a gift for you. We have Kay's Pleasing God series on CD, or also a card that has a website that you can go to download that series. And we want to give that to you as a gift. We have one more thing, so bear with us. We have a last slideshow that we're going to do with a favorite song my grandma loved to have sung at the retreats by Sandy Patty. But before we do that, Greg is going to come up and just close us in a word of prayer. Thank you.
I learned a lot about Kay I didn't know today. Chuck, thank you for those amazing insights about your mom. I don't think many of us realized how much she suffered in her childhood, and that just makes her story so much more extraordinary, but it also helps us to understand her empathy and compassion, because she was there. I was also shocked to find out that Kay thought I was a sociopath. Because I ride a Harley. And Dave Rolfe wouldn't even own it. So Dave, wherever you are, hey, hi. Anyway, let me just pray, and we'll all go out there and enjoy some fellowship, and I think we should sing a closing song. You'll know it. Father, bless now each one as we leave. We thank you for these memories we have of this remarkable life, a woman you chose to be your own for such a time as this, to touch her generation. And other generations have been touched as well. We pray for your hand of blessing to be upon all of her children, on Chuck, on Jeff, on Jen, on Cheryl, all the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren. Thank you for this family. Thank you that they loaned their parents to us. And because their parents were ministering to us, many times they weren't home with them because Captain Zoom Zoom was so busy. So we thank you for KZ and Captain Zoom Zoom, Chuck and Kay. And we thank you for this time to be together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, ready? The Lord bless thee.
The Lord bless thee.
And keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. And be gracious unto thee, be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. God bless you.
The sky shall unfold.
And the angels